Well, hello. Hey, there we go. It's on. Just want to say I'm excited to be here, even if I have to listen in headphones to hear myself introduced because I don't understand how Ninad was introducing me. This is probably the thesis of my talk today. So, networking. What's in it for me? A lot of people think about that. I think the better question is what's not in it for you as far as just business goes, or you could say that networking is how I met my girlfriend. You could also say lots of other reasons. I mean, last night I got Time Magazine might be a client of my company just through networking. So a lot of good things coming out of there. So when you think of networking, I want you to just kind of pause for a second and say, what pops into your head? A lot of people, it's, hey, I met you at this conference, and we had a great little chat for about 5 minutes, and then I took your business card, and then after that, I went away, and I honestly tossed it in the trash, and I never thought about you again. But I think there's also something, when you think of networker, what do you think of? In America, we have a term for calling networking a necessary evil, where sometimes there's people who are like leeches almost, where they come up and they're like, hey, who are you? What do you do? Can you help me out? And if they soon figure out that you can't help them out at all, then they move on. But I want to present an alternative view, which is kind of like forgetting about the what's in it for you sort of look, and more saying, okay, for these people who I meet, what's in it for them? And just kind of, I mean, it's a simple message, but I think that when we pause for a sec as networkers or as people, I mean, let's kind of forget about networking and just think about ourselves as people. Great networkers and helpful people are kind of synonymous. They walk up to you and they don't think, okay, what can you do for me? Or even what can I do for you? But they think, okay, how can my friends help you? Great networkers don't introduce themselves to the right people or figure things out. They always just come back and they say, I know someone in my network who can help you out here. So you might be sitting there thinking, okay, well, that's great, Jeff, but you know what? I'm really not one of those connector guys. I know who they are. I mean, we all know someone, we say, man, that guy is a connector. But a lot of us step back and we say, you know, I'm not that person. But, you know, a little confession. I was flying in here in Frankfurt, and I was sitting there in the airplane, and I thought, you know, I mean, I speak fairly regularly for business stuff, and one of the things that pops up again and again and again when I speak is, I wonder if the audience will ever figure out that I don't really know what I'm talking about. And in this case, I think that there's something where it's a bit pretentious for me to come in and say, oh, I'm a networker, I'm a great connector, when the truth is, you know, I haven't founded tons of companies. I can't make phone calls and just change your life right away. I can't do any of that. I'm simply a guy who just walked in here, and I know, you know, I've got a fair number of friends and acquaintances, and I am simply looking to help my friends as the opportunities come my way. And I think that's something that all of you guys can relate to, where when you walk out that door after this talk, you're going to be talking to someone, and you're going to have a chance to say, okay, I don't know what, you know, what are this guy's problems? Do I know anyone who can help them out? So that reminds me of a quick story. I graduated 6 months ago now. And I was, it was a long journey. but about, I guess it was a year ago now, I was working for this blogger named Ramit. And about that time, I thought, you know, Ramit, I've been learning a lot. You haven't been paying me very much. I think it's time we kind of flip that equation a little and I start making a little more money. And he thought about it and he said, you know, Jeff, it's just not worth it to pay you anymore. And he was kind of on the fence for a little bit. And I thought about it and I said, you know what, Ramit, rather than you hesitating about whether or not to employ me, I happen to know this guy who would probably be a great fit for you, where it would be a win for him and a win for you to get introduced to each other. And that was a year ago. And Ramit was one of the guys who tweeted this networking event. It might have been the one that Ninad saw. It might have been a different one. Matt, I still keep in touch with both of them. It was very much a win-win for both of them getting introduced. I think Ramit just hired Matt full-time at a salary far above he was offering me. And Matt has gone on to work as a freelance consultant in a number of different things based on stuff he learned. So this is this whole concept of win plus win, when you introduce people, is win cubed. But, you know, we all probably also know times where it's like, oh, you know what? You need a job. I know someone who can maybe get you a job. And that's not really networking. That's more like asking for favors, where you're just like, hey, can you, like, you know, help me out, dude, with this buddy of mine? And I do that every once in a while, but most of the time I try and just think a little bigger than that, think a little more creatively, and say, okay, rather than asking for a favor, how can I find an opportunity where both people are really excited about this introduction that I just made? Because if both people aren't excited, then the person who's kind of like, oh, man, dude, you introduced me, and you're wasting my time, he's not going to want to give the other guy any of his time, and it's just like lose all the way around. So the other thing I want to think about a little bit here, just briefly, is that networking and how you do it needs to come a little bit from your personality and your identity, who you are. I already talked about personality. Different people have different strengths. One of mine is remembering a lot of people's names. It just happens. And that's certainly, I mean, you can see why that's helped me out as far as just understanding different people. But for some people, they might have smaller networks, but they might be really good at building trust within those networks. Other people might, anyway, I'm getting off topic and I got already running out of time. But when you kind of flip it around, if you start successfully introducing people to each other, it can move from this where you're trying to help out your friends and you're trying to help out your acquaintances and people you meet to where it's like, man, I am the man. Like, I know everyone. Everyone looks at me. I had this in college. And I was like, man, you know, I walk down the street. Everyone knows me. And it wasn't so long before, like, I shifted from networking being about how can I help those that are my friends and stuff to networking being about how can I just glorify myself. And it wasn't long before I just, like, fell flat on my face. So how does networking work? So I'm just going to quickly walk through a couple of things I've observed, is that business happens, and this is business, let's think broader than just money. I mean, some of you might not be specifically in a distinct business field, but whatever, life transactionally happens at the speed of trust. If you don't have trust, things don't happen, or they slow way down. You spend a lot more time negotiating that contract, things like that. So there's three types of trust that need to happen whenever you're networking. There's character. So I like to think of this as, do I trust my mom? There's also competence. Do I trust that my mom can get something done? So in this case, like if my mom has a problem or something, am I going to introduce her to someone else? If I don't trust that her character or her competence, I probably don't need to do that. And then lastly, empowerment. So you guys could all come up to me and say, hey, Jeff, you know what? We really liked what you had to say. Can you introduce us to Bill Gates? And I could say, man, you know what? I trust your character. I trust your competence. My introduction carries zero weight. So that's this whole idea of empowerment. So trust cubed. Any one of those gets broken, trust is going nowhere. Introductions go nowhere. Business or networking rides on the back of introductions. We've all experienced time. So examples of these things getting broken. When character is broken, it means that someone used you. It's when someone comes up to you and says, hey man, how can I help you? And it's really about what can I get from you. When someone comes up to you and I've certainly done this or been asked to do this, to say, hey, can you introduce me to so-and-so? And I've had to say, you know what? You're a great guy, and I trust your character, but I don't really trust your competence. It's a hard conversation to have, but it's one that you better have with that person right up front, because if you don't, those two people are going to get paired up down the road because the other guy trusted you, and then they're both going to come back at you, or they're going to get frustrated, and they're going to come back at it, and it's just going to bite you. Trust, so it's like, okay, well, trust, how do we build trust? Close networks of friends, right? You trust your friends, you trust your best friends who all know each other, because if one guy messes up, then everyone else in that network knows, dude, you know, you don't go mess with that guy because he's not doing anything. So it would think, okay, well, high intimacy, high trust networks, we got two of them. Clearly, what's going to happen right here is the networking is going to happen within the red circles and within the blue circles. But what a lot of studies have shown is that the interesting thing is that the problem is that in the blue circles and the red circles, everyone already knows everyone's needs. So what you have is, if you disconnect trust and intimacy, they're certainly related, but word of mouth trust means that these kind of what they are called loose ties allow you to, they allow you to just network super effectively. So in this particular case, that single weak tie consistently will end up having the more powerful network. So if you have a lot of those weak ties, you're going to have a more powerful network. So maintaining an effective network simply equals having lots of acquaintances. Now, I don't recommend giving up all your friends just to have lots of acquaintances, but I do recommend working hard to just every so often touch base every 6 months or a year. I have a bunch of appointments on my calendar that just say, hey, just touch base with this guy. Facebook and Twitter, easiest ways in the world to keep up with people because I can quickly see what they're up to, stuff like that. The other thing that helps as far as like scanning and having this acquaintance network is simply just remembering people and remembering names. One of the things I worked on in college when I was leading small groups in the dorms was as soon as I walked in the door, I was to that dorm and I had to meet a bunch of people, and I meet like 20 freshmen all in a row, and I'm like, I can't keep your name straight. And I just had to train myself time and time again to, as soon as I got introduced to someone, when I heard their name, like alarm bells went off in my head. So very much is something, whenever I come to a conference now, I hear someone's name. It's been a little more complicated in Croatia. But certainly when I hear someone's name, just like, okay, I gotta remember that. One of the other things is, as a networker, trying to figure out, okay, how can I help people remember who I am? And so one of the things when people come to me for networking advice is I say, you know, when you introduce yourself, does your story answer all the questions, or does it provoke more questions? So if I come to you and I say, oh, I graduated from college, yada, yada, or whatever, oh, I'm just kind of working as a marketer, or whatever. But if I come to you and I say, oh, man, we're doing this really cool thing, and I give you about half the story, you're going to be sitting there like, oh, my goodness, what's the rest of that story? Guarantee you, curiosity, help, do your best to help people remember you. So you might also be sitting there, this is something that I have no problem at all talking to strangers. It's just who I am. My girlfriend, the exact opposite, like we'll be going somewhere and she'll be like, hey Jeff, can you call them? Because I don't want to talk with them on the phone. I'm like, what the heck? But one of the things that I also kind of came up with to help her out a little bit is what I call the three H's of, you walk over to someone and you're like, man, it's super awkward. What do you say? You both want it to work out, but what am I going to talk about with this person? So I just said, you know, what about if you think about it's super simple. It's the history, habits, and hopes of just simple categories. And that'd be another way of saying, like, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, right? And so when I walk up to someone, I still do this, and don't get freaked out if I'm like, oh, man, what am I going to ask next? I don't know how to have a conversation with this person. What am I going to ask? We have nothing in common. I'll just ask, okay, what's something about their history that I could ask about? Super easy, super simple of just, where are you from? Where did you grow up? Your habits. What do you like to do on the weekends? Your hopes. Oh, really? Well, what, you know, where would you see yourself in 5 years in your career or something like that? Guarantee you, this is super simple, lifesaver. You know, one of the things this is one of my mentors right here. I love this picture because it expresses to me a successful outcome of a very awkward encounter in relationships called the first date. And I think, like, if people on a first date can make it work out, then certainly two strangers who don't have all the pressure of, oh, is it going to work out? They're just like, man, you know, we're just going to see each other for 5 minutes. They should be able to make it work out. So one of the other things that I always tell myself when I walk over to a stranger is just like, you know what? He wants it to work out. I want it to work out. It's going to be awkward for a little bit, but if we just keep talking, it'll work out. And we'll probably find something interesting. So networking is a continual choice that you make. This is something want to harp on a little bit. You walk out that door today, every single break, it's like, okay, do I go talk to my friends who I already know, or can I go meet someone else? And then can I go make the choice to actually hear what they're saying? And then can I make the choice to actually understand, to hear the things behind what they're saying, kind of the problems? I guarantee you that if you went outside today and you heard three people and you talked with them for 10 to 15 minutes, you would hear something where you'd be like, oh, he's talking about this, but I kind of think that I could help him out. And just being creative there, being creative is one of the other things. So the two things that I see different skill levels in networking is people who have an ability to scan a lot, and then people who have the creativity to say, okay, I've got this extensive network, here's some solutions. But I think it's something that certainly can be developed, and certainly the more you do it, the more effective it is. I can totally remember an example of this. I think it was last year. My buddy Eric, CEO of a startup, was talking with me briefly on Skype one night, and he was like, hey, I'm trying to, you know, we don't have a sound engineer. I'm just trying to edit this podcast. It's so frustrating, whatever. And I was like, oh, well, Eric, you know, I got this buddy Brian who is totally a sound engineer, and we were just editing a podcast earlier today, and I was like, oh, look, he's online. Let me just introduce you to. And I knew that Brian was also looking for a little bit of freelance work. And I introduced him, and later on, both of them like called me back up, and they said, hey, we really appreciate you making the introduction to both of us. So if you think about it again, having the creativity, when someone's going to come up to you, and they're not necessarily going to say, hey, can you introduce me to someone, but they're going to be just saying, here's my problems, just always be thinking, okay, how can I help them out? So then the other thing I think I've experienced multiple times is I go away from a conversation, and someone says, oh, man, you totally got to meet my buddy. He's going to help you out. And I never hear from them again. And I'm like, oh man, I was really hoping for that. If you want to be a successful networker, develop a reputation as someone who takes the time to actually execute on what you do. So when it's like, you get an email that says, hey Jeff, you and John, by the way, my talk, like I revamped the talk and forgot about the title when I was doing it. But so don't even worry about the title of the thing. But I get emails like this, maybe you get emails like this that say, hey Jeff and John, you guys should totally talk. Peace out. And it's kind of like, what are we talking about? Like, how much do you know this guy? How much do you trust this guy? All these things. And what a lot of times happens is, first off, there was no permission asked. A lot of times when you're introducing, unless you're introducing peers, one guy's a little busier than another, you should go to that person and say, hey, do you mind if I introduce you? I think there's a win-win, which really means that the person who's doing the introducing needs to be take the responsibility to put a detailed email introduction. So a lot of times the assumption is, oh, whoever's doing the introducing, it's not really that much of a responsibility. I'm just going to quickly go ahead and do this email and let them kind of figure it out. I would rather, and I found it far more effective, if I write two paragraphs that say, here's what you are, here's how you're good at, here's who you are, how I know you, what you're good at, and how I think you can benefit. And I write that for both parties, and I send it publicly to both of them so that they're both very aware of what's going on. Making yourself a good networker is making yourself findable, and also it's making yourself helpable. So a great way to make yourself helpable, I got an email about 3 months ago, and a lady said, hey, I'm graduating from a business college with a degree in finance. Can you help me get a job? And I'm pretty much willing to work anywhere in business. And I thought, well, lady, I know a lot of business people. Who am I going to ever introduce you to? And the counterintuitive thing that you need to keep in mind is that for networking purposes, it's actually better if you niche yourself tighter. So in fact, you want to be someone who is kind of the best at your particular niche. And the two ways to do that are to either get better or to shrink your niche. So for example, my company, I don't say that we're the best at Facebook marketing, I say we're the best at Facebook fan page marketing. Super tight niche, only a certain subset of people in the world really need our business, but those particular people, we quickly get the introductions because everyone knows how to box us up. So lastly, I just want to say, today, as you go out there, take some time, someone who you're try and find three new people to talk with, but not just that, and be looking for, okay, what can I talk with them about? But be thinking, okay, for at least one of these folks, the odds are you should know someone who can probably help them out. The last thing, there is a four-story slide. I was very depressed this morning because I promised myself after writing it once yesterday that I was going to write it twice today, but it looks like it's closed down. But anyway, thank you very much.